Hello, everyone, and welcome to episode 84 of the Rock and Roll Beer Guy podcast. We are back from our holiday break, and I'm bringing you a special guest, Mr. Ken Horne of the band The Bronx. Also, Mariachi El Bronx. We talk a lot about his career, his writing process for The Bronx, where the idea came from to do the mariachi version. We talk about Japan, we talk about beer, and we talk about records. I had a great time talking to him, and I hope you guys enjoy. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Cheers. What's up, everyone? Welcome to another episode of the Rock and Roll Beer Guy podcast. I'm here with Ken Horne of the band The Bronx and Mariachi El Bronx.
Hey, hey. Thanks for having me.
No problem. You've been with the band playing guitar and doing backup vocals since the first major release, right? The 2006?
Yeah, 2006. I didn't play on the album, but I joined right when the album came out.
Ah, okay, okay.
Yeah, so yeah, I joined 2006.
Very cool.
So going on 13 years.
Damn, it's a long time, man.
Yeah, that was quick, too.
It flies when you're having fun, yeah?
Yeah, exactly.
I wanted to ask you, because I noticed on your Instagram, you usually post with hiragana.
The Japanese.
Are you Japanese?
Yeah, I was born and raised there, and I moved to San Diego when I was finishing up high school, and then I went to college, and I played in a band called the Dragons in San Diego for 13 years, and nice. then I moved back to Japan for like 2 or so years, but then I came back and joined the Bronx from 2006.
Very cool. And how was when you moved to San Diego? Were you already speaking English? Did you learn when you moved over, or how was that?
Yeah, I'm half Japanese, so my father's Japanese, but okay. I went to an American school. My father's American, and I went to an American school. So I was already, like, when I came to California, I was already like, dude, what's up?
Very
so, yeah, cool. I knew English. I mean, sometimes I say stuff that's a little, not weird, but, you know, kind of, I probably think in Japanese and then said it in English, or sometimes vice versa, you know?
Right. Yeah. I mean, yeah. I come from a Spanish family, so sometimes I say things backwards.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
That's very cool, man. And when you were growing up, I mean, I've heard stories that, you know, growing up in Japanese culture, it's very strict sometimes. Was it like that for you, or were they very supportive of your aspirations?
Yeah. Yeah, my family was totally, you know, they didn't really, you know, they're like, do whatever you want, kind of. But, you know, there, some of my friends, you know, they had like pretty strict parents, especially like around my era, like, you know, when I just turned 48. So in the 80s, I was like, you know, junior high, high school, and some of my friends, they couldn't have like long hair or like, you know, just because even the school too, they had, you know, Japanese schools were pretty strict, where I went to an American school, so it was like, you know, it was just like, you know, a school in California. But yeah, my parents were pretty supportive, you know.
Nice. So why San Diego? Why not like maybe the East Coast?
My dad's from Boston. So we were going to move to Boston, and then at the last minute, his work, you know, it was San Diego. But I'm glad it was San Diego, just the freezing winter and all that, you know.
For sure, and it's such a different vibe. I mean, I've lived on both coasts for half of my life each time, and you know, especially up northeast, like, you know, New Jersey, that's where I'm from.
Yeah.
It's the cold is ridiculous, and the attitude and the vibe is a lot more intense and edgy, and like everybody's angry because it's so cold. You know, yeah, like San Diego is a lot more chill now, you know.
Yeah, when I was like 13, that's when I first visited here, and we visited Boston, and you know it was like November, so it was already like freezing, and you know.
Yeah.
And then we went to like New York and like Rhode Island, kind of just up and down the East Coast for a vacation. But it was cool because I've never been to the States before. You know, I've never been to a house with a basement. You know, my cousins were playing like hockey in the basement and all that. So
nice.
It was different. You know, and then we went to like New York. New York was cool. You know, it was just a crazy big city, but. You know, in Japan, I was born and raised in Yokohama and Tokyo, so it's, you know, I kind of knew the big city already. Yeah. But then California was, you know, California was a little different, you know, just the weather was nice and the people were nice, but it's just like all spread out, you know, you have to have a car to go everywhere. And
oh, yeah. Everything's like 20 minutes away.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a big change for me. I was born in Jersey, lived there till I was 15. Then I went to Miami from 15 to 34, 33, something like that. And then I just, you know, in the last couple of years, I've been here in L.A. And it's just such a different energy and vibe. Like, Florida is Florida. I don't know how many stories you might have heard of Florida. coming here, everybody's a lot more polite. Everybody's nice and
calm.
You know? Except for like Hollywood. Hollywood can get a little weird.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, you know, well, it was good. Like I said, San Diego's, you know, more a smaller town than LA, and everyone's nice, and you know, it was cool.
Yeah, I love visiting San Diego. There's a lot of breweries down there, and I got a couple friends. It's just a lot more. It's way more mellow than Los Angeles, even. So I love visiting it. But going back to the band, the band is based out of L.A., but it's called the Bronx. So did it originate in the Bronx in New York, or how was that?
No. It was L.A., but you know they named it because back then, Bronx started around 2002. So, you know, back then there was the whole East Coast, West Coast rap, you know, war.
Yeah. Okay.
So they just, you know, they just kind of did the whole, you know, we're from L.A., so we're called the Bronx, you know.
Nice.
Not making fun of it, but kind of being, you know, funny about it, you know.
Sure, yeah. And then you guys also do the Mariachi El Bronx, which I think is hilarious. I mean, and it definitely shows the Los Angeles influence.
Yeah.
And is, you know, where did that idea come from just to do something like that? And you know, if anybody's listening that doesn't know, you know, that you guys do a whole other set of music in the style of Mariachi music. So
yeah. So like when Bronx 2 came out, when you do like press, you know, they ask you to do like a, you know, like an unplugged thing on TV or radio or whatever. So then, but then, you know, Jovi, our leader, was like, you know, punk songs don't really sound good unplugged. It's just, you know, an unplugged guitar pretty much.
Right.
So I think it was like Fuse TV or something. And he had the idea of arranging one of the songs called Dirty Leaves into an acoustic like mariachi thing. So they got like a which he happens to play in Mariachi El Bronx now, but back then he was just a friend, and they just kind of did a random mariachi arranged song, or you know, arranged tune. And Joey was like, oh, I'm gonna try to write mariachi songs. So then he went and wrote like three or four mariachi type songs. And he gave it to Matt, and Matt put, you know, words and melody over it. And when I first heard it, I was like, oh, this is going to work. This is going to be cool. And then we got in Ben Sidalgo, who plays Guitarón, which is the bass. And he And he comes from, you know, his father's Dave Sidalgo from Los Lobos. So he kind of came in and told us, you know, what was Mexican and what was Spanish, you know, the difference between the two. And then he kind of taught, you know, he taught me how to like kind of, you know, play the traditional way. So we all kind of figured out how to play. And from there, we just kind of wrote the whole album.
That's badass, man. Los Lobos are awesome. They had that one hit on the From Dusk Till Dawn soundtrack, right?
I think they do the whole soundtrack.
Right.
Yeah.
Dude, I love that song.
Yeah.
That's badass.
Yeah, those guys.
It's such a unique idea.
So that's where it came from, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, no one thought of it. And then, you know, traditional mariachi, they just kind of do old songs and, you know, the traditional songs, and everyone kind of just, you know, plays the traditional songs. But we wrote our own songs. We, you know, sing it in English, and then we have drums in it. So it's, you know, it's a little different, but it's very cool.
And are a lot of the songs original, like the Bronx songs that you have transcribed into that style, or they're just completely original?
Completely original. We've never played a Bronx song mariachi style. It was just mariachi was mariachi. And then next thing you know, we have, you know, three albums.
Yeah, and it's a super smart idea, because I read an interview where you mentioned that, you know, it helps with booking shows, because some shows don't do, like, you know, a full band. They want an acoustic set or something like that. And this is
Yeah, and then, like, you know, there's more, you know, like, there were a lot more opportunities, different opportunities with mariachi, I think. You know, we got to do, like, the late night shows, and we got to do, like, Glastonbury Festival, which is, you know, we got to do a little more, you know, festivals that were a little more eclectic, you know. The lineup was a little more eclectic. So, you know, that's kind of cool, you know, we get to do different things.
Yeah, dude, that's I love it. I love the idea. Did you guys get any kind of backlash from, like, the, like, Hispanic community or something like that about this, or?
No, pretty much none. You know, you know, there's, you know, you think there's kind of like a machismo world in that whole world, you know, especially like kind of the, you know, the Mexican culture, but everyone was totally cool, especially like the, you know, girl mariachi bands, and, you know, everyone was cool about it. No one's giving us any kind of shit.
That's great. Yeah, because you would think that they'd be like, they'd uphold some kind of strict traditional rules or something, like, oh, you need to do certain things or play certain types of songs. I don't know.
It was just like, you know, I thought, because we wear like the charro suits, but we kind of do everything out of respect. We don't, you know, mock or make fun of any of it, you know.
Right. Yeah, it's a serious thing. It's not a parody or anything like
that. Yeah. And we played with a couple mariachi bands, and, you know, it was totally cool.
That's awesome. Have you guys played any shows like in Mexico, Mexico City or something like that?
No, we want to get down there. It's kind of hard to get down there. So we've had the offers, but it's never come together all the way, you know.
Sure, and now there's a giant wall in the way, so
there's always talk, so
that's cool. And you guys tour constantly, man. I mean, I see you guys on the road all the time. Most recently, I think I saw you guys with Thrice.
Yeah.
And you sometimes tour with both bands at the same time. Is that a thing?
Yeah, we do. Yeah. We sometimes do, like, we don't do it that often, but we do, like, the, we did one or two tours where it was like the mariachi opening and a band in between, and then the Bronx. Or we do like a back to back, like one day mariachi, the next day Bronx in one city.
That's cool.
Or festivals where mariachi would play one stage later on in the night, the Bronx would do, you know, a set on a different stage. That's kind of cool. I like that.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. Yeah. Big festivals like Ozfest or something like that, where they do like the multiple stages.
Yeah. I can't remember what we've done it a couple times where we've done both bands.
You know, I feel like a lot of those big festivals like that we're talking about are kind of going away. I know Warped Tour just tapped out, and they're doing their anniversary show thing, but Ozfest is not touring anymore, you know, like.
Yeah, it's just, I think it's different now. We played Reading and Leeds this past summer, and then, you know, you could just tell the it's like different bands, and, you know, the crowd's young, and it's, you know, it's probably cool for the young kids, you know. It's like when we were younger, and probably, you know, all the 40-year-olds were going, who wants to go see a bunch of punk bands, you know? Right. I think it's just a, you know, change of the times, too, you know?
Yeah, how do you feel about, like, where punk stands right now, because you guys are a pretty hardcore punk band, and I feel like, I don't know, modern music is not really leaning into that vibe anymore.
Yeah, well, I don't think, you know, it's, you know, I don't think it's really changed that much, you know. It just kind of went back to how it was, kind of, you know, because, you know, like, yeah, not underground, you know, but, you know, when, you know, when Green Day was huge, it was like all those, you know, it was just like this whole punk revolution, the second coming or the third coming or whatever. And then those bands kind of went on to get, you know, big. And, you know, in Europe, you know, all the punk festivals, you know, all the bands, there's still a bunch of punk bands and all the crowds still come out. You know, we did a bunch of punk festivals this summer, and, you know, they were all good.
Well, I guess that's in Europe is might be I don't know. Maybe I don't get out as much.
Yeah, there are a lot of bands still, you know.
Yeah. Do you still play with the Dragons too, or no?
Yeah. We're doing the Casbah, San Diego's Casbah, is 30th anniversary is this year. So we're doing two nights next weekend, January 11th and 12th.
Oh, that's badass.
Yeah. So that'll be fun. Yeah, there's a lot of, you know, Casbah has, you know, a lot of cool bands come in and play in on their anniversary month, which is January every year. So I think, like, Hot Snakes are playing tonight. You know, Chinchilla's playing tomorrow. And we play next weekend. It's just a bunch of old San Diego bands getting back together. And, you know, a lot of touring bands that come through playing too. So.
Yeah, dude, I might try and make it out to that. I was actually talking to my buddy Adam. He plays in Killswitch Engage, and he lives down there. He's in town right now before going on tour. And I told him, I was like, "Yeah, I'm gonna come down on the 11th. Maybe do another podcast, and it'd be cool to check you guys out."
You should come out.
Seen the Dragons live? That'd be cool. I saw a picture on your Instagram of you guys playing naked.
That was like in 97 or 8. We played naked a couple times.
Oh, man. Do you still? That can't be done these days.
Sexual
assault.
Our bodies have changed too much.
Yeah, there's also that, yeah.
I can't hide the gut anymore.
Yeah. It's like plopping over the guitar. That's great.
Yeah. Like if I play the guitar high to hide my gut, I wouldn't be able to hide my
gut. Man, I was reading also, you guys recently added Joey Castillo on the drums. How's that been for you guys?
That's been awesome. You know, he's a monster, you know. We go back and forth with Dave. When Dave plays with Social Distortion, Joey comes in and tours with us. And Social Distortion happened to be pretty busy last year, so Joey was playing with us more. But, yeah, he's a monster. He's awesome. He's a great guy, too. They're Dave and Joe. They're both, like, inspiring guys, you know. He's been in the music business for so long, you know. It's just cool. Yeah, it's cool hearing stories, you know, of, like, the 80s and kind of the early 90s of everything happening, you know.
Hell yeah. When you guys tour, what are some of the things you like to do when you're on the bus or, like, when you go to a town or something like that?
We always go out. We try to make, you know, if it's a new city, we always try to make a, you know, point to go out and kind of, you know, walk around, just kind of taking the sights. And if we have a day off, we always go out and we all kind of go and have dinner together, go to the local dive bar, punk bar or whatever. But I always go and I buy records, so I'm always walking around looking for record stores, you know. But now it's easy with all the, you know, all the iPhones with the GPS, you know, where before I couldn't remember where that record store was, or, you know, now you just type in record store and like five of them come up and you can walk to it, you know.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, so that's cool, you know.
I love doing that too. Like, just, and I'm so grateful for the technology that, you know, you never feel lost when you go out of town now. Like, you just,
exactly, yeah. Yeah.
It'll show you a little graphic exactly where you need to turn, and, you know, it's fun.
Yeah. But yeah, we always go, you know, there's always the local friend or like a local bar we go to, or, you know, we're always up to something.
Well, that's good to hear. I know a lot of bands, especially when they've been around for as long as you guys, that, you know, they just don't do anything, or they don't even hang out together. They're like separate dressing room or whatever.
No, we're always together. We always do stuff, you know. The majority of the guys, we always kind of stick together and do stuff, you know. Everyone kind of has their own thing that they like to do, so they'll do that too. But, you know, at the end of the day, we're always like eating dinner together or hanging out together.
That's cool, man. That's important, yeah, for the music and just the general like existence, because it's basically a marriage.
You know? Exactly.
You're married to, you know, 3-4 other dudes, and that's just you got to make it work, and you got to hang out together and treat it as such.
Anyway. Yeah, yeah, we get along really good. That's all great. Of us. Yeah. You know.
What are some of your favorite bands to tour with, like on a tour package?
Oh, I mean, I don't know. I mean, every tour is pretty good. We become friends with all the bands we tour with anyways, you know? Mm-hmm. But like, you know, the tour with Thrice was awesome. We became great friends with the guys from Teenage Wrist, you know? Nice. We did a tour with No Parents earlier in the year. That was great. You know, not a specific band, but, you know, we pretty much get along with everyone, so...
If you had a dream tour package, or like a package that you haven't already done, like what would you want to do?
I don't know. I can't think of it right now. I don't know. Like, you know, we play festivals, and like one of my favorite bands is MC5, and like they played after us on the same stage, so I got to watch that. You know, we've been pretty lucky where, you know, we get to see a lot of cool bands. My favorite band is Hanoi Rocks, and the singer Michael Monroe came up and played with us when we played in Finland. Well, he sang with us. We played a Hanoi Rock song, and he sang, and then he played harp on, you know, the song White Guilt we do. It's more of a rock and roll song. He came up and, you know, played harp on that. So
that's badass.
Yeah.
That's gotta feel good, man.
Yeah. It's, you know, surreal sometimes, you know. It's like, yeah, you're just like, yeah.
Do you still get that, like, do you still get like a, I don't know what the word is that I'm looking for, but when you're on stage and like something crazy is happening like that, like one of your favorite singers is up there with you, or there's a giant crowd and they're all like really feeling it. Like, do you acknowledge that in the moment, or is it something that happens later that you're like, holy shit?
I think I feel it more later, but then some, yeah. You know, when the crowd's going, you know, obviously kind of, you know, the adrenaline or like the excitement kicks in a little more too, you know? Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah. Every time I've played shows in front of a, like a big crowd, I kind of get lost. Like I try and acknowledge the audience, but I also try not to, because the anxiety doesn't like, you know, get to me or anything. But, I always, like, after the fact, I'm like, man, I should have paid more attention. Or, like, I was so busy trying to do the thing, you know?
Yeah, I always do that.
I wanted to ask you a little bit like nerdier type of question.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Like, when you're shaping the sound of your guitar, like the tone, what are you mostly looking for? Like, are you going for a more like old school punk sound, like more of a aggressive, like bright tones, or what is it that you look for?
I guess I go for kind of a thicker, fatter tone, but we're just like, Joby's kind of, he's a tone master. He's like, you know, he gets great sounds out of his amp, you know, out of his setup. But we both use the same head and same cab, different guitars, but we have, you know, we don't even use pedals really, you know, we only use it to kind of boost the solos or, do stuff like that. But we just go straight into the head pretty much. And it's, nothing's really dying. It's just, it's loud. It's loud and it's just loud and fat. A good, you know, I don't know how to say. It's not like distorted that much, but it's not that clean either, you know?
Sure. It's mostly like peaking, I guess.
Yeah. We try to go for like a good tone without it distorting too much.
Right. That's kind of essential for the punk rock type of music. Like, you don't want to have a giant pedal board when you're like running around and jumping up and down. And
That's, you know, good rock and roll sound is what I go for.
Yeah, and I saw you're like an official Marshall artist. Is that like your favorite piece of gear?
Marshall. I've been using orange cabs lately, and I use the Midas guitars. But the Marshall I bought like in 1990.
Oh, man.
Yeah, I bought it for like $500 when I was like 19 or 20 years old, and I've had it ever since. Yeah, never modded it, never done any, just, you know, just the usual maintenance, but I've done nothing to it, and it sounds great. But like while we're on tour, we always get like, you know, we borrow, you know, we rent gear when we're overseas, and we always get a JCN 800 Marshall.
All right. So have you thought about the switch to orange since you've been using the cabs?
No, I like all kinds of other stuff, but just for the Bronx, it just, you know, the orange really fits, you know. Mm. I mean, the Marshall head really fits the sound, I think.
Right.
I know how to, you know, dial it in with the Marshall, you know. Because if you go overseas and you ask for an orange, you don't know what kind of orange you're going to get, you know.
Right, yeah.
You know.
Yeah, the headquarters are out there, so you might get all kinds of different things.
Yeah, and then, you know, sometimes we ask, you know, because over here, like, my head's a JMP. Our heads are JMPs with the two inputs. But when you're overseas and ask for a JMP, Marshall JMP, they give you the four input one, which is kind of like more of a vintage sound, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Which is, I mean, I guess could fit what you guys are doing a little bit. I don't know. I feel like you guys do have like an old school sound, old school punk sound, you know, which I love.
Yeah, yeah. I think so too, yeah. But for the last record, Bronx 4, we recorded with Rob Schnapp, and he has all kinds of gear. He has like 40, 50 guitars, vintage heads I've never even heard of. But I didn't even bring a pick to that recording. I used all of his gear.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. It was all like, you know, like I used like a 53 gold top. I used like a 65 Telecaster. He had one of those Nash strats. He had everything, Firebird, non-reverse Firebirds. And my favorite was the Les Paul. And I used it through a Marshall Super Lead or a Fender Bassman.
Nice.
And Joby went for more of like kind of like the custom type guitars that was made for Rob, like, you know, like a Dan Electro type guitar with a weird head, you know. But yeah.
That's awesome.
So for recording, we'll try to use a lot, you know, we'll do anything. But for, you know, live situations, I think that's the sound is like the Marshall and, you know, orange cab or just the, you know, Marshall and a 4x12 and, you know, a good solid guitar. Get a good Bronx sound.
Hell yeah. And so are you guys writing a new music? I know you...
The most recent
album came out in 2017, right? Number 5 or
V? Yeah, we're kind of like we're not playing till like March, so we're just kind of like piecing stuff together right now. Yeah, yeah.
When you get into that mode of writing, like what are some of your like rituals? Like how do you inspire yourself to come up with these riffs for the band and keep it fresh and not like, you know, when you're getting into the fifth and sixth albums, like you kind of have to keep it fresh or else it's just going to get redundant, you know, for yourself.
Yeah, I don't really do anything. It's just whatever comes, you know, or, you know, yeah, whatever comes out or what I think of, I just kind of try to piece together.
Okay, all right. So yeah. You don't have like a ritual, like you don't
nope.
set up candles and
nope. Like... I don't do anything.
That's good. Keep it raw and real, yeah. Which is nice.
Yeah. You know, yeah. But then, when you're on tour, you play like the same guitar. But then when I come home, there's like a couple other guitars I have. So like, I'm like, oh, let me play this one because I haven't played this one in a long time, So I guess that, playing a different guitar is, kind of inspiring, I guess,
Yeah. Yeah. You get different sounds, different, little nuances that you can play with.
Yeah. Because I'm not like, I don't listen to something and I'm not like, I'm going to write a song like that. Yeah, I guess it's just.
Do you go in with like a template of like, okay, well, this is what a Bronx song sounds like, or do you just let it flow completely free?
Flow free, I think, because yeah. because we always write songs. At first, we kind of demo songs and we send it to each other, mm-hmm. We send it to mostly to Matt so he could come up with the words and the melody. To it, but like Joby will send songs and I'll be like, oh, you're gonna do that, or I'll be like, oh, it's pretty cool because he'll write songs and I'll be like, oh, I didn't even know that you were gonna do that, or like I didn't even it's kind of hard to explain,
No, I hear you. So you guys write separately though, you're not like writing in a studio together, you just send each other a riff here and there,
and then we get into the room together,
After you got some ideas, penciled in. Yeah.
Yeah. Because, nowadays, everyone's busy, so you can't go in the studio for 8 hours and be like, all right, who has a riff that we could jam on for 5 hours,
I'm assuming some of the band members that probably have kids at this point.
Yeah. So we kind of have a template, and then we go in and we just kind of work on stuff that's already, kind of built up a little bit. Like Matt and Joby will sit down and work stuff out a lot too, though,
Do you have kids?
No.
No kids.
There's Joby has kids, Joey has kids, and Dave has kids. Me, Brad, and Matt are single guys, childless.
Nice. Childless. I think that's, everybody obviously can do whatever they want, but if you're going to be in a band, like if that's your career, it's important to not have that responsibility kind of tugging at you,
Yeah, it depends on that person, A lot of the guys, work it out really well, And that's kind of probably inspiring for them too, having kids and just kind of having that lifestyle,
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it gives you a whole different inspiration or I guess meaning behind what you're doing, because what you're doing now is trying to keep someone alive. So
yeah,
you got to make sure you're doing it right.
Exactly. Yeah, it all works out. Yeah. A lot of musicians have kids nowadays. Well, I guess from even the old days, Dave, he grew up, falling asleep on drum risers, watching his dad, and, the singer from the Dragons, he comes from a huge musical family too,
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, it's nice to keep it in the family too, like grow up in that world and
yeah.
Keep it going. It's a legacy at that point,
Yeah. Yeah, I know. Sometimes I'll see that sometimes and I'll be like, oh, that's cool, I want kids, but then when I get home and then, I don't have to do anything like that. I don't have any responsibilities. I'm like, I might be okay. I don't have kids right now.
I'm like you, man. I feel you. I mean, I'm 37, 38? I don't even remember. But I'm 37, yeah, and I don't have kids, and I don't have plans either because I barely have time now. So to have to, think about having to feed someone else and make sure they're not doing something dumb and hurting themselves or something, it's too much. I can barely keep myself together, so let's not do that.
I get to, yeah. All seems like all of my friends have kids, so I could, for like 3 hours, I could hang out with the kids and maybe play with them and then, come home and be kid-free. I used to work at elementary schools too. So I used to, I was like, oh, kids are awesome. And then, but then I didn't have to go home with any kids. It's like, all right,
right,
I'm done.
Right.
My day's done,
Yeah, it's a lot nicer when it's someone else's and you could just, hang out. I've been told I'm good with kids. Like, I could, they enjoy playing around and, I throw them in the air or whatever and they're happy. But yeah, I'm glad that I get to go home and not have to deal with their nonsense.
When we're on tour with Bryce, Tepe, their guitar player's son, came out like the last 5 days. And like, he's like old enough, he's like 11 or 12 or whatever. And I thought that was kind of cool. He was like on the bus, sleeping in the bunk and then waking up in different city and then watching his dad from the side of the stage. I was kind of, I thought that was really cool. Yeah.
Yeah. No, that is a cool aspect of it. Like there obviously there's positives to both sides. It all depends on what you want in your life at the time.
Yep. Yeah, you can't be buying guitars anymore when you have kids. You gotta buy diapers.
Exactly. Let's see. I have a few more random questions. Like, do you?
Yeah.
So I've seen you. I've seen the Mariachi El Bronx on Lucha Underground. Are you a wrestling fan at all, or was that just kind of a gig?
That was just kind of a gig, but. Wrestling was huge in Japan when I was growing up. It still is, but so.
Yeah.
A bunch of my friends were like, "Oh, you're doing the Lucha Underground," So.
I've recently become a big fan, and like, I was a fan as a kid, but then I recently got back into it, and Lucha Underground's a big deal, and the New Japan right now, like, they just had their big once a year event actually last night, I think it was.
Yeah, my friend just went. He's from New York, but he was like, "I'm going to Japan. I'm going to go watch the wrestling stuff." You know who's over there is, Andy Williams from Every Time I Die?
Yeah.
I think he went to watch it, or he's doing something over there.
That's awesome. I haven't talked to him since their show here in LA a couple weeks, maybe 3 weeks ago. I don't remember the anniversary show they did here.
He was
on the show, and he's a good friend.
Yeah, he's awesome. He's super nice. He's a cool guy.
Other question, if you could do anything besides music, what would you do?
Oh, I don't know. I always think of that, but I can't think of anything.
Is there anything you enjoy, cooking?
I cook, but I don't enjoy it. I guess work at a record store.
Oh, okay.
I guess that'd be cool. I always tell everyone that's my dream, is work at a record store.
Just hang out and listen to records all day.
Exactly.
Sound too bad. If you could do another project, what type of music would it be?
Not more rock and roll, I guess.
More rock and roll? Okay.
Yeah.
More angling towards like a Queens of Stone Age type of vibe, or?
No, more like Rolling Stones type vibe, I think.
Oh,
Rolling
okay.
Stones. Or more 50s. More 50s type stuff.
Okay.
Yeah. Or like super low budget garage rock. Like, garage rock that's recorded with a, a Sony Walkman type stuff.
Nice. I have a question from Facebook. Somebody wants to know, if you could be any animal, which animal would it be?
What do you call those that just hang on trees? Either a tiger. Either a tiger or sloth.
Those are two vastly different animals. Oh, man.
It's like, I want to be really badass or do nothing and just hang out. Yeah, just chill.
Oh, man. So,
or a koala. Koala.
Koalas are cool. I haven't had that experience yet with them. Like, a lot of my friends go to Australia for shows, and they get the picture with the hugging the koala.
Yeah. You get to eat leaves all day and have, people hug you all day, hold you all day.
I heard they're sticky. Like, their fur is sticky.
I don't remember.
Have you gone down there and then played?
Yeah, we went. Yeah.
That's awesome. That's pretty cool. So you mentioned a lot of bars hanging out. Are you a drinker?
Oh yeah, yeah. We all are beer lovers, you know. We do We like the. I know you're into all the crazy beers from listening to your podcast, but we go for. We like our IPAs and all the craft beers, but we're kind of the simple guys, you know. I always go for the lighter Modelo, the Asahi, the Japanese beers, you know. Mm. But yeah, you know, a lot of my friends from San Diego, like, are, you know, have, you know, breweries now, like Fall Brewery, Thorn Brewery.
Oh, I know them.
Yeah, I've been friends with Dave, the owner of Fall, since, you know, for like 25 years, you know.
That's awesome. So, have you guys talked about making a beer together, like doing a Bronx beer?
There's always talks of someone doing a beer for us, and I always want to do it, but it never, you know, comes together, never happens. But Dave, yeah, I'd like to do one. You know, sometimes, I can't remember where it was, we were in Europe somewhere, and someone made a beer for us and then made a you know, label with one of our t-shirt designs, and they gave us like a six pack of that. That was pretty cool. It was a bottle, but it's like a homebrew type stuff.
Sure. You guys should definitely jump on that, man. I mean, it seems to be getting more popular. I recently had the Atreyu one. They did one with Noble out there in Anaheim, I think it was.
Yeah, that'd be cool. Yeah, you know, we've definitely talked about it a couple of times. But it would be cool to have our own beer.
Hell yeah. And I mean, it could be that style, that you know, the simpler kind of like a lager, pilsner type of thing, you know.
Chuggable
beer.
Yeah, that's what I like.
I've been going backwards, man. It's so crazy because I recently left the beer industry, working directly with them, and have been focusing on my new gig, and have been kind of, you know, not paying attention. And when I go buy beer now, I'm like, just, you know, lager, something simple, you know, and something I could just chug while not really having to sit there and like dissect the hops and like, oh, the smells like this. And like, I just want to drink.
Yeah, me too. You know, even back in the 90s, San Diego used to have a lot of like, you know, kind of a little beer thing going even back then. Mm. And, you know, I try out the different beers here and there back then. And then I used to really like Guinness. So I used to try to be cool, and I'd go into a bar anywhere and I'd be like, give me the darkest beer you have back then. But now I'm like, what's the lightest beer you have, you know?
Sure. I still go out and experiment, like when I see something on a like a tap list, I'm like, all right, that sounds crazy, give me 4 ounces of that, and then give me a full pint of, like, you know, a lager or a pilsner to kind of wash it down.
Oh yeah. Our bass player Brad, he's, you know, he likes the craft beer a little more. Like when we're on tour and we'll go to you know, a random, you know, bar, nice. he'll try out the, you know, local, you know, ale or local whatever. I don't like the fruity stuff too much. That's my thing.
The fruity or like the sour stuff.
Yeah, I like the, you know, I like the IPAs or, you know, like you said, more of the pale lager type stuff.
Beer flavored beer, man. So is that your drink of choice, like when you go to a bar, or do you enjoy cocktails too, or just the beers?
Just the beers. I do like, you know, some cocktails here and there, but not too much. I do, you know, I like I like mixing stuff with like whiskey and soda, or tequila and soda.
Like soda, like, water, or
soda water, like, you know, bubbly water. In Japan right now, everyone's into highball, whiskey and soda.
Interesting.
Yeah, so that's like the drink right now.
I do a lot of vodka soda too. Like that one seems easier for me. You just put a little lime in it and you're good.
Yeah. And another thing that's popular in Japan is called a hoppy, which is like you mix, there's like a white hoppy and a dark hoppy, and you mix, it's kind of like, it's almost like beer without the, you know, the bubble. It's just like a flat beer almost.
Oh, okay.
I don't know how to explain it.
Yeah, no, they call it still beers too. Like they have that in, it's big in Belgium too.
Yeah,
it's just non-carbonated.
Yeah, but that's popular. I don't like that one that much, but I do like the shochu mixed with water, or just shochu and warm water, or shochu and soda. Nice. I think I like the club soda mix better.
That's awesome. Yeah, dude. I've been obsessed with Japanese culture since high school. Like, I mean, I took 2 semesters of Japanese. I understand it pretty well, and I used to be able to read hiragana and katakana, but I can't do that anymore.
Yeah.
It went away. I still have all my workbooks. So one day I plan on sitting down and like relearning everything, but it's cool to understand the language. Like I'm the company I'm working for right now is a Japanese company, and I hear them around the office all the time talking, and I'm like, I understand what you're saying. I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, I used to tutor Japanese at San Diego State. You know, the conversation tutoring.
That's awesome. Yeah, yeah. My old teacher was. We also it was high school, like senior year, so we used to torture him.
And, like, oh God!
Random things. Like one day we decided to we passed a note around and like everybody stand up and go hug him, like at the same time. And he was like freaking out, like, what are you guys doing? What's happening? He's like, we're just hugging you, man. He would teach us like bad words and stuff. And like, he would, he taught me, what was that he taught me? Watashi wa manko tabemasu.
Oh, you gotta beep that out on the show.
Nah, this is uncensored. I don't care. So am I correct in that the translation is I eat pussy? Is that right?
Yep.
Yeah, he taught me a bunch of like really bad things that I should not know.
That's crazy.
And that's always been my dream. I told myself I was going to do it when I was 30, but it never happened. But now the new goal is 40. I want to go to Japan.
You got
to
go.
It needs to happen.
A lot of people, you know, I think lately, especially with, you know, with everyone like posting stuff on Instagram, just the internet, you know, there's so many, you know, people from all over the country over there right now, you know?
Hell yeah. I mean, Conan O'Brien did a thing out there recently, and
yeah, like it's
a whole
crazy
series of videos. Yeah.
Yeah.
I definitely want to check it out one day.
Yeah. 2020 is the Tokyo Olympics.
Oh man. Maybe not during that time.
Yeah, exactly.
Everything is going to be a little more expensive during that
time. Yeah.
All right. So a few last minute questions here before we wrap up.
Okay.
Favorite food.
Favorite food, probably sushi or Japanese curry.
Oh, nice. Okay. Favorite smell?
New vinyl record.
Oh, nice. Okay.
Even an old moldy one.
Just records in general.
Yeah, just records, yeah.
Favorite color?
Black.
Okay. Do you watch, are you a watcher of movies and TV shows? Like, do you binge the Netflix?
You know, I stopped, I think, because I don't know what it was, but before, you know, like 10 years ago when it was like TiVo and all that, I used to watch every show, every stupid show, every series, whatever. But now I don't do any of, I have Netflix, but I don't watch it. I just watch music documentaries and like music movies, I guess, you know, or old. I just go on YouTube and watch like old music footage, stuff like that. I haven't binged the show since Breaking Bad.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. Like everyone's like, oh, you got to watch this, you got to watch that. And I always keep it in the back burner, but I never start. So I haven't binged watched anything in a long time.
interesting.
Yeah, even like, you know, some people give me, like, you know, for like a Christmas gift, you get like a little box set of whatever. And I haven't even started with those yet.
Yeah, it's become like a big part of the culture now. That's all the conversation pieces people do, like in the office or whatever. It's like, oh, did you watch this? Did you watch that? It's like,
yeah, I don't watch any of it. Like, you know, sometimes the guys are talking about it, and I'm like, I don't even know what they're talking about. I know the names of the shows, you know, and then I was like, oh, I want to see that, you know. Or I sometimes get in the conversation, I'll be like, oh, let me, you know, tell me what a good show is so I can watch it. But I never ever do it anymore. I don't know what it is. I don't have the attention span too, you know. I'm guilty of that, you know.
Well, you don't really have a lot of time either. I mean, you're constantly on the road or doing something, so.
You know, a lot of the European buses come with like a huge hard drive that has like movies and TV shows, you know. Mm-hmm. And I guess we used to watch TV series, but not too much anymore. One time we tried to do 24 in 24 hours, like watch 24, stay up for 24 hours and watch each episode, a season of 24.
Oh, wow.
We never did it though. We got tired around the sixth hour probably.
Yeah, man. I mean, I like watching TV, but I also have this weird thing where, when I have too many options, I tend to not do anything.
That's me. Exactly. It's like, you know, I have these books I want to read. I want to listen to these records I bought. You know, I want to, you know, play this other guitar I haven't played in a long time, you know, but then I end up just going on Instagram for about 3 hours, you know?
Yeah, it's weird. I mean, there's certain stores, like there's a store in Florida called Tate's, and it's this just enormous store with everything. It's got like comics and toys and movies and, you know, or Amoeba here in LA. Like every time I go to Amoeba, I'm just like overwhelmed. I don't buy anything. I stare at everything. I'm like, oh, I want all of it. And then I just leave.
I know. Whenever I go to Amoeba, I always go there when I'm about to do something in that area, so I can't go in for a long time, so I just kind of go to a section, and I'm just gonna stay here. Like I always go in the 7-inch section, and I'm like, I'm just gonna stay here and not move for an hour and then leave.
Well, I was gonna ask you earlier and I completely spaced out, but you mentioned you collect vinyl, so how many records do you have at this moment?
Probably close to 1,000 or so.
Ooh.
Like, you know, those IKEA,
the perfect vinyl shelves.
Yeah. I have like two of those that's almost filled.
Wow, man. Yeah. I'm nowhere near that. I love collecting records too, but I only have, I have one of those and it's not completely filled out yet. I don't know the number, but
like I've been doing it for, you know, I've been doing it for a long time too. You know, I've never stopped really since. I still have like, you know, cassettes and records that I bought in 85, you know, all the Japanese versions I still have.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah. Like I know, you know, I like when I was about 15, I sold like 50 records. And with that money, I bought another record and I was like, I'm never going to sell a record again. So I haven't really sold a record. I didn't sell CDs for a long time, but I ended up kind of, you know, getting rid of the stuff that I didn't really care for anymore, you know. But the records, I never sold records in 7 inches.
Yeah, I still have quite a bit of the ones from my childhood, the records from my childhood. I inherited a few from my father, and but that I remember actually playing when I was a kid, you know, playing with them, like old Michael Jackson records and, you know, Led Zeppelin records and Pink Floyd. And I've been able to keep all of that, but I've lost all of my cassettes and CDs from back in the day, man. Like, that really bums me out. I don't even know where they are.
Yeah, I've hung on a pretty good chunk of everything, you know. I've never really sold or got rid of stuff.
Yeah,
but
that's good.
Yeah.
That's a good backup plan if something happens. And, you know, you're like in a tight spot, but like, well, I have this old original Japanese press that's probably worth $1,000s, you know.
I don't think I could do it though.
You can't, man.
But records, I love records, you know, just the whole culture of it, you know. I love, that's a cool thing to do when we're on the road, is going to record stores. I like that a lot.
Nice,
man. Yeah.
All right. And finally, the last thing I have here, if when a young fan comes up to you at a show, what piece of advice would you give them? And also, like, do you enjoy receiving compliments and, like, you know, getting punished, I guess is the word I'm looking for.
Yeah, like, you know, we're all pretty good about it. I don't mind I kind of like the nerdy questions, you know, like people asking me about gear or like how you recorded this or like what do you use for that, or like, you know, I like all those, you know, nerdy questions. You know, I don't think they're nerdy. I think it's actually kind of a cool question. You know, like sometimes people hit me up on Instagram and they'll be like, "Hey, sorry to bother you, but what did you guys do for this?" And I'm like, you know, I always answer everyone back. You know, I have no, you know, I like doing all that. You know, I like, you know, when we're asked to do for some tour promotion, can you make a playlist, you know? And I love doing all that. You know, I do that stuff, you know, normally. So, you know, I'll answer, you know, anything like that's totally cool.
Yeah, and would, if you were to give a piece of advice to a fan, like somebody who's like, man, I love what you're doing, what would you recommend I do?
Yeah, I guess just keep at it. You know, a lot of kids now kind of quit real easy, you know. It's not quit, but there's so many, you know, like we're talking about, there's so many things to do, you know. Now it's like, oh, I'll learn how to play guitar, then I'll be, you know, I'll do a DJ thing, or I'll do, you know, I don't know what the kids do now, but, you know, it's just like, you know, I've been like, you know, playing a band since I was 18, you know, and I never thought, or, you know, never wanted to quit really, you know. I always just wanted, you know, even in any capacity, doesn't have, you could be playing in front of, you know, your friends, or you could, you know, you could play in front of thousands or whatever, but like, I guess just keep at it and enjoy what you're doing, you know?
For sure, man. And so you plan on doing this as long as physically possible?
Rolling
Stones?
I think so. Yeah, of course.
Hell yeah.
Yeah.
Very cool, you know. Well, what? Go ahead.
Hello? Nope. You were just cutting out. Sorry.
Oh yeah. No, I was going to say, thank you so much for taking some time to talk today, man.
No problem, man. I love, you know, talking about like nerdy stuff. So I love, you know, and those questions don't, you know, bother me.
Very cool, dude. So, if I end up going to San Diego next weekend,
yeah,
I'll hit you up, let you know. Maybe we can grab one of those.
Yeah,
fancy
let me
beers.
Know. Yeah, there's a, what's that? There's a, I think, Blast.
Ballast Point?
Yeah, there's one right by the Casbah. It's, like, walkable.
Nice, nice.
Yeah.
And do you know Adam from Killswitch or no?
No.
Have you met him before?
Okay. No. Yeah.
Well, I'll hit you up. Maybe we'll swing by.
Yeah. Let me know.
All right, brother. Thanks again.
Right.
Social media
you.
For you is, I'm sorry, Destroy.
Mochikoshi.
Destroy_all_mochikoshi.
Yep.
And obviously, you know, Google the Bronx and the Bronx band, not just the Bronx. Otherwise, you'll get the New York City. And keep up with the band. I mean, like you said, you're writing new music, so hopefully, you know, this year, next year, you'll have some new music out.
Yeah.
Cool.
All right,
brother. Well, cheers.
Arigatou gozaimashita.
Aha.